We welcome all of you for today's webinar, that is RGHS and ECHO India training program for COVID-19 awareness program. And today's topic is the management of dental and maxillofacial surgical patients during COVID-19 pandemic. And the speaker is Dr. Murali Mohan Chuntaru. Is oral and maxillofacial surgeon from Mangalore. So we welcome you, sir, on behalf of the vice chancellor and the registrar. We welcome the today's speaker, and also we welcome all the participants from various dental colleges, the faculty members, postgraduates, and we welcome the dental practitioners also. Over to the VC sir for the opening remarks.
Very good afternoon. On behalf of RGHS and ECHO India for this online education program, I welcome my friend Dr. Murali Mohan for this program. And as you all know, our dental students and interns and postgraduate students and faculty of our colleges, they have been working day and night during first wave and second wave. And we have lost many of our friends also. And we should appreciate all our the faculty members, those who have worked for this the emergency cause during this pandemic. And my friend Dr. Murali Mohan, we were studied together. He's a very good maxillofacial surgeon and professor of maxillofacial surgery in AB Shetty Institute of Dental Science, and he's a very good clinician and very good writer. He has published many books in Kannada, and he is presently a home commandant in Mangalore district, and it'll be a very very informative talk. I welcome Dr. Murali Mohan for our important online program.
Please mute yourself.
Now I welcome this today's speaker, Dr. Murali Mohan. Please take over the stage, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. It is indeed a great pleasure and honor to me to deliver a guest lecture on management of dental and maxillofacial surgical patients during COVID crisis. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Jaikar Shetty, my good friend, and the Honorable Vice Chancellor of Rajiv Gandhi University. Thank you, sir, for your kind words and encouraging words. I am ever grateful to you, and I will try to do justice in this 1 hour how to manage the dental and maxillofacial surgical patients during COVID pandemic. And I congratulate Rajiv Gandhi University for this wonderful, amazing initiative to do this COVID awareness education series. Previous Vice Chancellor Dr. Sachidananda sir, as well as Dr. Jaikar, to continuing this legacy and on this COVID pandemic times. It is the need of the hour to educate the students, public, and we ourselves, the practitioners, to update the knowledge and how to manage the patients. It is the need of the hour, and I am really, really grateful for the initiative taken by the Rajiv Gandhi University. And in the next 1 hour, I'll try to do justice for this topic. So coming to the introduction, as we are aware of the situation, currently the number of cases affected over the globe, across the globe, is 18.45 crores of people has been affected by the COVID-19 disease, and more than 40 lakh people have lost their lives. And if you take the statistics in India, more than 3 crores of people have affected by this COVID, and 4 lakh deaths have occurred in India. That shows the magnitude of the disease, the magnitude of the pandemic. So it's all started in the year 2019, in the month of December. It started causing havoc across the world, starting from China. This sudden outburst and the spread of the virus left the entire medical field in a dubious situation. We were in a real trouble. When it started, everyone thought, okay, it is in China, we are safe. But within no time, it's been spreading like a wildfire, and more than 180 countries even now are suffering from this great pandemic disease. So the healthcare workers are at very high risk of contacting this disease. General public are more prone. And when we are working as a frontline warriors, dental surgeons, maxillofacial surgeons, general physicians, ENT surgeons, and ophthalmologists, and all the healthcare workers are in the real high risk of contacting this disease. So because this SARS-CoV-2 virus is known to spread through the aerosol, mucosal, and respiratory droplets, and also by contact with an affected person. So in that sense, it is a very, we were in a very tragic situation when it began. So coming to our dental fraternity, we have, most of the dentists have suffered, and our profession is the one which has suffered the maximum. You can't imagine how it has changed the way the dentists are practicing in the world now. So a lot of changes have taken place. A lot of emergency cases are requiring intervention of oral and maxillofacial surgeons, include procedures that are invasive and involve usage of aerosol generating drills. So these aerosols are, you know, that is what the creating more problems, spreading the virus. So literature reports says that approximately 4 in 5 virus positive patients are asymptomatic. The real problem lies here. If the patient is positive, symptomatic, fine, we can identify, we can exclude, we can postpone, or we can defer the treatment. But the problem here is every 4 in 5 virus positive patients are asymptomatic. You never know. So this demonstrates the importance of risk stratification during outpatient visits and hospitalization. Here we are facing a huge problem: how to segregate these patients, how to find out, how to manage these enormous volume of patients. So that is where the problem. So standard precautions based on the Center for Disease Control and area guidelines for dentists on the coronavirus disease, it says this is a universally accepted mandate. Everyone should follow, when to postpone the treatment. Following the announcement of the disease outbreak by international local authorities, dentists play a very, very significant role in disrupting the chain, thereby reducing the incidence of the disease by simply postponing all non-emergency care for dental care for the patients. So this is a very, very critical and crucial situation. We have to decide when to treat, when not to treat, what to treat, where to treat. This is where the problem. So if you know the patient is positive, fine. If it is not an elective procedure, if it is an elective procedure, we can always postpone. But if you don't know whether the patient is positive or not, there the problem starts. So we healthcare professionals have to follow the mandate what universally accepted. So question is where to treat. So all dental care should be provided in an outpatient dental setting with the minimum 6 air changes per hour, such as a hospital with the dental care services or customized clinics equipped for COVID-19 patients. So we need to treat all COVID positive patients should be treated in a hospital setup with all the equipments, protecting equipments, personal protective equipments. So we cannot treat in simply in all the places. So that is where the actual situation, actual demand, need of the hour. So symptoms, if you see primary non-specific repeated reported symptoms of COVID-19, we are all, we know patient will have fever, dry cough, and dyspnea, breathlessness, or muscle pain, muscle weakness. These are the general symptoms. Or some patients will have diarrhea also, loss of smell, loss of taste, all these things. In this, if the patient comes with these type of symptoms, or patients have traveled to one of the countries considered as a disease hotspots in the past prior 14 days, or have encountered the patients, people who have traveled to these countries. So in these scenarios, we have to take a proper history and we have to exclude this. And some patients may be asymptomatic or unexpected symptoms, like, as I mentioned, diarrhea. So these things we should be critically observe, critically make note of it, and we have to take a call. And how long? Since it is not possible to know the etiology of each patient's illness, it is crucial to follow the guidelines and precautions at all times during the disease outbreak. So we cannot say now the second wave is over, we can come back to normal dentistry. We have to take maximum precautions. And what are the preparations and arrangements we need to do? We should be very alert, identify the patients with the respiratory illness, provide them a disposable surgical face mask, isolate them in a room with the door closed, limit the contact with the others. Isolated patients must wear masks outside their room. So this is to prevent the contamination, prevent the spread of the disease. We have a major social responsibility to prevent the, to break the chain. So isolate the suspected patients before it and during the care to minimize the direct contact with other patients and staff, and immediately report any such cases to the local or state public health authorities. So we cannot hide the facts. We have to inform the authorities so that they will, you know, continue the other precautionary measures. So transmission prevention consideration, to prevent this transmission of the disease, dental practice should, practices should adhere to the infection control protocol, including the hand hygiene, providing tissues and to no touch receptors, and providing face masks for coughing patients. So dental healthcare personnel should wear the white coat, gowns, head caps, goggles, face shields, masks, and all the possible personal protective equipments to prevent exposure. And disposable masks should be substituted between the patients or even during the treatment if they get wet. So these are the universal protocols we have to follow. And we should constantly update the guidelines, which is always CDC guidelines are updated every week. So we have to follow these guidelines and we have to practice as per the guidelines. And healthcare workers are strongly, CDC strongly recommends that all healthcare staff, including the dental staff, dentists, personnels, all should get a flu vaccine shot and also influenza to prevent, must, without that one should not work. So what is the recommended personal protective equipment for healthcare workers modified with the WHO guidelines and European Center for Disease Prevention guidelines? So when we are working in an inpatient unit, patient room or examination room, what are the precautions we have to take? Everything is mentioned in this beautiful article. So patient room, examination room, fine. Patients has no COVID symptoms. Simple medical mask and FFP1 mask is sufficient, respiratory sufficient. So when we are providing direct care to the COVID-19 patients, we have to use FFP2 respirator or N95 respirators and gown, gloves, cap, eye protection, all these things. And when we are doing an aerosol generating procedure, say restoration or oral prophylaxis on a COVID patients, then we better wear FFP3 respirator or N99 respirator, where 99% of protection is provided from the virus. and all others disposable gowns, sterile gloves, surgical head caps, all the things one has to follow. And when you are treating in an outpatient units, clinical examination patient without the symptoms, mask and N95 is sufficient. Whereas in the consultation room, if you are a suspect patient with the suspected symptoms, we have to use N95 and all other protective equipments to prevent the transmission of the disease from the patient to the doctor or from the doctor to the clinical assistants and other people who are in the working area. So this is how the transmission dynamics in a dental care settings. Here we are treating a patient, the patient as well as the assistant. So here it can spread through the direct exposure to the respiratory droplets, secretions, blood and saliva, and or indirect transmission can happen through the contaminated surfaces or through the instruments or inhalation of the suspended airborne virus. So patient is breathing, the virus can sustain in the air, which can directly communicate come in contact with the nursing staff as well as the operator. So also mucosal contact, we come in contact with the oral saliva, mucosa or occlusal mucosal contact, all these can cause the spread of the disease, spread of the virus. So one should be extremely, extremely careful. We have to protect ourselves, protect the lab personnels or the nursing assistants with all the possible equipments, which what the ADA guidelines says. So surfaces in dental clinics serve as a venues for the droplets and the aerosol mixed with the patient's saliva and blood. They can effectively help the spread of the infections. So coronavirus can actually maintain their virulence at the room temperature from 2 hours to 9 days. One should always remember the virus which has been come out of the body and in the room can stay up to 9 days. And their activity at 50% humidity is as significantly as high as 30%. So therefore, in a dental environment, it seems that keeping the surface clean and dry will play a vital role, very significant role in preventing the COVID-19 virus transmission. In addition to this, routine dental practice, when you are doing an endo procedure, say a root canal or any cosmetic restorations, always we should prefer to use rubber dam so that contact with saliva and mucosa is avoided. And preferably, mouth rinse with 1% hydrogen peroxide or 0.2% povidone iodine is always better, so that the contaminated, the viral load is reduced. And also anti-retraction handpieces and should be used. Appropriate disinfectants like 0.1% sodium hypochlorite, 0.5% hydrogen peroxide, or 60 to 70% ethyl alcohol. These are all the surface disinfectants routinely, daily, on a daily basis, or daily, twice a day basis, we should use in the clinic so that the transmission of the virus and the contamination can be minimized. And also, management of the medical waste is also very, very integral part, very important. Imagine you have treated a COVID-19 patient. These has to be disposed in a double yellow bag with the gooseneck ligation, and we should be mentioned COVID-19 waste. And without that, we are going to transmit the disease. So dental biofilm also plays a very important role in the transmission of the disease. It's one of the beautiful article mentioned in the journals of clinical periodontology recently in the 2021. It says dental biofilms from a symptomatic COVID-19 patients harbors SARS-CoV virus RNA and might be a potential reservoir with an essential role in COVID-19 transmission. So one should be extremely careful. So this source should be considered when defining the appropriate preventive measures to stop the spread of the virus and reverse the increase in case numbers. So dental biofilm also plays a major role. One should be aware of this to mitigate the spread of the disease. These are the period consideration. Then coming to the what are the procedures, primary procedures, which can be performed with aerosol procedures, non-aerosol procedures. So non-minimally invasive aerosol producing procedures like examinations, follow-up, suture removal, non-surgical extraction, soft tissue biopsy, silent endoscopy, abscess drainage, IMF for facial bone fractures, arthroscopy or TMJ lavage. These are all minimal aerosol producing procedure which can be safely can be done with proper precautions. Whereas other aerosol producing procedures like surgical extractions, dental implants, sinus lip procedure or alveolar reconstruction or alveoloplasty, bone regenerative procedures, open reduction and internal fixation of the facial bone fractures, craniofacial and orthognathic surgery, ablative procedures, episectomies, and open TMJ surgeries. All these need a, these are the procedures what we should be extremely careful. So as per the article mentioned in the Alterman et al. In the clinics of oral investigations, here it says, does the patient, the protocol what we follow is, if the patient is having a fever, imagine patient comes to us, then if he is having fever and is he COVID positive, then patient should be referred to a hospital, to a negative pressure treatment rooms in a separate building assigned for a COVID-19. You should never treat these patients on a routine dental setup. And the patient is not having fever, but even then, if patient is does not have any other symptoms, even then, if COVID is positive, we have to defer the treatment. If the patient does not have any symptoms, negative, so then minimally invasive, non or minimal aerosol producing procedure, we can use grade 1 PPEs, personal protective equipment. These are the protocol, like surgical masks, face shields, long sleeve disposable gown, disposable head coverings, and pre-procedural mouth rinse. Pre-procedural mouth rinse is 0.2% chlorhexidine and 0.3% hydrogen peroxide. It is not been proven, but it definitely going to reduce the viral load, which can be effectively implemented in a routine dental setup. Whereas aerosol producing procedure, which I have mentioned in the previous slide. So here, what we have to follow the grade 2 personal protection equipment category. Here, N95 covered with the surgical mask, face shield, long sleeve, disposable gown, and disposable head coverings, and pre-procedural mouth rinse. These are the protocols given by the Alterman et al. In a recent study. So one should adhere to these principles so that we can break the chain and prevent the spread of the disease. This protocol is found to be effective in preventing the staph cross-infection with the COVID-19 in oral and maxillofacial settings. So these are the study done in February 21 to April 23rd, 2020. 1,471 patients were treated in an outpatient clinic and under general anesthesia. That is 67 in under GA, 1,404 in outpatient unit, local procedures. So all procedures were carried out under strict emphatic protective protocol that included patient screening, personal protective equipment allocation protocol, frequent staff testing, and patient testing before general anesthesia. So these are the treatments here. Both emergency and urgent elective procedures are included in this. This is the protocol what we have to follow. So what are the recommendations coming to the maxillofacial surgery per se? For surgical patients, what are the recommendations we have to follow? We have categorized on a priority basis, low, intermediate, urgent, and emergency procedures. What are the low priority procedures, like orbital decompression, orthognathic surgery, primary and secondary surgery for cleft lip and palate, secondary reconstructive procedures, surgery for TMJ pathologies, treatment of craniofacial malformation. So all these procedures can wait. You don't have to do during COVID pandemic crisis. You can always defer the surgery until the COVID-19 pandemic settled. There is no harm postponing these procedures. Elective procedures, by postponing a month or two, we are not going to lose anything. We are not gaining it, but we do gain by preventing the breaking the chain of the spread of the disease. So So that is why it is very important. If you say the intermediate priority, benign slow-growing tumors, closed fractures with limited impairment of the functions, large cystic lesions, surgery for TMJ pathologies that cause severe pain, so treatment of craniofacial malformations with sleep apnea and elevated intracranial pressure. So these can be deferred, but one should, with the word of caution, deferral of surgery until COVID-19 pandemic situation has settled, as long as the risk of the deferral are under control. If you cannot control the risks, you can continue to do the surgery following all the COVID-19 protocols. So COVID-19 patients, one should be take a proper call at the right time with the by postponing, you are not going to do any harm to the patients. And what are the urgent procedures which cannot wait? We have to do immediately the deep neck, head and neck infections without the risk of airway obstructions, malignant tumors with or without the reconstructive procedures, orbital decompression, open comminuted fracture, tracheostomy. All these things cannot wait. You have to do it. Whether COVID positive or negative, you have to do it. You have to take proper precautions and you have to go ahead and save the patient's life and also prevent the transmission of the disease. And emergency procedure, deep head and neck infections with a risk of airway obstruction, severe hemorrhage. When there is a trauma and when there is a hemorrhage, even if the patient is COVID positive, you have to do it immediately. Immediately you have to control that bleeding. Deep head and neck infection with severe hemorrhage. All these things cannot wait, irrespective COVID positive 19. But you have to follow all the protocols which I am going to discuss. So guidelines, what are the guidelines of maxillofacial patients, which is given by the NIAC SS et al. Here, positive for symptoms, patient referred to the infectious disease department. Surgery is warded off till the results are declared. So until and unless it's proved positive, you always consider as a positive. So negative for symptoms, here primary resuscitation and the stabilization of the patient has to be done. And routine of maxillofacial surgery patients, we have to do the general investigations, complete cell blood cell counts, vitals, chest x-rays, and cardiac investigations, cone beam, CBCTs, all these things is as and when needed, we have to do it. Then we have to classify the procedures, emergency, urgency, and elective procedures, and defer elective procedure to a later date. As I mentioned in the previous slide, the simple procedures, which can always defer with the minimal risk to the patient, we can always defer. So elective procedure and should be postponed to prevent the spread of the COVID-19 disease. So if the displaced fracture, which requires immediate intervention, surgery to be scheduled and it has to be done, we cannot postpone it. Then minimum operating room personnel, do not allow everybody inside the operation theater. Minimal manpower is needed, we can utilize that and do it. Entry of surgeon into the operating room only a few minutes before the surgery, after the patient has already been prepared by the anesthesiologist. Because the more the time spent in the OT, the more risk for the surgeon to get contaminated with the virus or get infection from the virus. An undisplaced fracture is treated by an arthropod fixation or only a conservative management. That is also a good option because lesser the exposure, better the transmission of the, we will be controlling the disease. Restriction of the post-operative stay of the patient to a maximum 3 to 4 days and allow the access only one patient attendant to be with the patients. These are the things. So categorization is very, very important. Category, this is one of the very good study published in the year 2020, Sahni et al. So here, what they have done is a wonderful chart. All postgraduates can note this. See here, category 1, 2, 3, 4. Category 1 is emergent, immediately has to do. So hemorrhage, infected injuries, posing for threat for a further spread. So you cannot defer, you have to do it immediately. Then urgent procedure like orbital trauma. You have orbital injury with the progressively reduced visual acuity. The patient has a problem. Intraorbital, retrobulbar hematoma, things like that. So any injury posing threat to the airway also, we cannot postpone. You have to do it immediately, irrespective of the status, COVID positive or negative. So intermediate procedures like closed fractures, assess the functional impairment, and you can defer. Functional impairment may increase when presented at a later date. So consider performing the deformity correction later. Counsel the patient and inform the patient, take a written consent and postpone it. And low priority cases, like any injury with the conservative modality of management without progressive impairment of the function, here again, defer the surgery, talk to the patient, take a written consent, counsel the patient, convince the patient that even if you postpone, there are going to be any change in the prognosis or any change in the degree of deformity will be minimal, and you can always postpone. So this is the diagrammatically algorithm. The patient with the presents to the accident and emergency with the maxillofacial injury. Here, in addition to routine history and other COVID has to be done, then till proved otherwise, treat all patients COVID-19. We always remember, till it is proved, we have to follow all the protocols, COVID protocols. Then triage, and we have to categorize. Category 1, 2, 3, and 4. Category 1, 2, as I mentioned in the previous slide, you have to operate and you have to settle the things. Category 3 and 4, you can always defer and you can always counsel the patients, and you can justify your decision with the proper counseling of the patients. Then coming to the fractures, lower face mandible fractures. Consider close reduction with the self-drilling maxillomandibular screws, fixation screws. So scalpel over the monopolar cautery for mucosal incision, better to use scalpel. Bipolar cautery for hemostasis on a lower power settings. Self-drilling screws for a monocortical screw fixation. When drilling is required, limit or eliminate the irrigation so that aerosol generation is reduced. If drilling is required, consider battery-powered low-speed drill. And if fracture requires open reduction and internal fixation, consider placement of maxillomandibular fixation screws intraorally, then place a bioocclusive dressing over the mouth. Use a transcutaneous approach rather than a transmucosal intraoral approach. So if osteotomy required, consider osteotome instead of power saw, again to minimize the generation of the aerosol. So mid-face fracture, again consider close reduction. Alone, if fracture is stable following reduction, otherwise consider using Carroll-Giralt screw for reduction. This is for the zygomatic complex fractures to avoid intraoral incision. And if two-point fixation is sufficient for stabilization, do it extraorally. Otherwise, generally in a non-COVID patient, we do most of the procedure intraorally to minimize the scar. And scalpel over the monopolar cautery for mucosal incision, avoid repeated suctioning and irrigation. By doing suctioning irrigation, creating more aerosol and spreading the disease inside the operating room. Bipolar disease for hemostasis on a lower power setting. The self-drilling screws to be preferred. If osteotomy needed, again, osteotomy is instead of power saw or high speed drill. So this is again to prevent the reduction of the aerosols. Then coming to the upper face. Here, consider delay of non-functional frontal bone sinus fractures because nose is connected, well connected to all the sinus, sphenoid, ethmoid, frontal and maxillary sinuses. So it is easy. Virus will be spreading everywhere into the sinus. So consider the delay and endoscopic endonasal procedure and associated instrumentation carry a very high risk of aerosol generation and should be avoided if possible. When performing frontal sinus obliteration or cranialization, consider performing the mucosal stripping manually, not using a burr or a power equipment. Again, by doing that, we are creating more aerosol and virus transmission. Avoid repeated suctioning and irrigation, and all the other protocol will be the same. So what is procedure on outpatient with the, that's all about the maxillofacial trauma. What to follow, what not to follow, when to do it, what to do it. A good surgeon is the one, he knows when to intervene, what to treat, when to treat. And sometimes not doing any treatment is also a part of the treatment. So wise judgment from the doctor or the surgeon makes you to take a right decision at the right time so that the spread of the disease is minimized. Now, coming to the other aspect of the maxillofacial surgery, that is oral cancer. Oral cancer is also a, you know, the fourth most common cancer in head and neck because of the tobacco and other habits. The incidence of oral cancer is increasing day by day in younger generations. So clinical examination must be carried out with personal protective equipment and should be limited to low risk cases or those patients where there is a low clinical suspicion of malignancy. So in case of malignant disorders like oral cancer that need urgent surgical procedures, performing surgery in an otherwise healthy patient is proposed. And in case of oncologic patients infected with COVID-19, surgery can be performed in the same way, reinforcing the biosecurity measures and through the monitoring, thorough monitoring during the recovery period. So biopsies is indicated in case of suspicious malignancy due to the fact that this is a considered an emergency procedure. Do not delay. If you feel that the lesion is looking like a malignant, please do the biopsy. Do not postpone it because every day we gain by doing this, it's a blessing for us. So absorbable suture should be used to minimize the second postoperative contact, and cleaning and disinfecting the exterior of the container after taking the sample should also be done performed well. This is again the minimize the contamination. So head and neck oncological surgeries are extraordinarily high risk for SARS-CoV-2 viral aerosolization and transmission to the operating room personnel. So here involves multiple routine aerosol generating procedure like bag wall mask ventilation, intubation, nasogastric tube placement, and tracheostomy, repeated endotracheal tube removal and replacement during total laryngectomy and airway suctioning. So one should be extremely careful. We have to follow all the possible protocol to minimize the disease spread. So surgical intervention is warranted in following scenarios. Here, when to treat, it's very important. Cases in which worst outcome is expected if the surgery is delayed more than 6 weeks, like squamous cell carcinoma of the oral cavity, oropharynx, larynx, and hypopharynx. Giving a reason of COVID and postponing the cancer surgery is not ideal. We are doing a great damage by doing that. So surgical intervention is mandatory. Cancers with impending airway compromise, again, has to be done immediately without compromising the sterilization and cross-infection protocol. Even if the patient is COVID positive, we have to do it. Then high-grade progressive salivary gland malignancy, again, the time is very, very crucial here. T3, T4 limb melanomas, again, every day is very crucial. Then salvage surgery for recurrent and persistent disease and high-grade sinonasal malignancy where non-surgical options will not be equally effective, so efficacious. So in these cases, one has to be take a proper clinical judgment and one has to do the procedure immediately to save the patients. The airway management, I will skip. It's not in the syllabus. Okay. Now, coming to the oral manifestation of the COVID-19 and its management in a dental setup, oral manifestations. Several studies have been reported on a COVID-19 high prevalence of symptoms like gustatory dysfunction, xerostomia or burning mouth, sialadenitis, inflammatory reaction in the salivary glands and the tongues. This the literature also reported various opportunistic fungal infections like mucormycosis, ulcerations, and herpes simplex virus due to COVID therapeutic interventions. This also one should be extremely, extremely careful. A lot of reported cases of black fungus or so-called mucormycosis has been reported. It has been well documented in this public health journal in the year 2021 by Chakraborty et al. The following topical management of oral diagnosis can be administered for the oral lesions like hyaluronic acid gel and chlorhexidine 2% mouthwash or gel twice a day for 14 days in patient with ulcero-erosive lesions, miconazole nitrate twice a day application in the cytological diagnosis of candidiasis, tranexamic acid for local hemorrhage, and
Previous studies have suggested biopsy in the absence of feeling after 14 days among mild COVID patients with prior rinsing with the chlorhexidine 2% at least 1 minute for 1 minute before doing the biopsy to reduce the overload. So it is recommended that to perform an extensive intraoral examination in recovered COVID-19 patient to find out any related oral manifestations. Here, dental surgeon has a major role post-COVID scenario because a lot of reported cases of black fungus. So one dental exam, routine dental visit and examination by the dentist is a mandatory. We as a dental surgeons has a more social responsibility compared to any other persons because of the ongoing chaos about this mucormycosis. So dentists should have a high degree of clinical suspicion and keep COVID-19 associated mucormycosis in the differential of severely ill patient with COVID-19 and especially those who have a diabetes mellitus, especially if rhinoorbital rhinocerebral presentations are noted. So one has to have a knowledge about this. One has to have a open ears and eyes to identify this. And if you identify these lesions early, one can treat better. And the prognosis will be very good if you start treating these lesions in the earlier stages. This is rhinomaxillary mucormycosis. It's a lot of cases have been reported in the first wave of COVID-19. We never had this problem. After the second wave, thousands of cases have reported with the mucormycosis. So second wave of pandemic in India has seen a drastic rise in rhinoorbital mucormycosis. So this mucormycosis is a rare invasive fungal infection that originates in the paranasal sinuses and may frequently extend into orbits and cerebral parenchyma. So ideally, one should identify in the beginning itself. And if you start treating, you can do a lot better in controlling this disease. Once it reaches into the brain, we are helpless. Even with the good medications, it's very difficult to protect the patients or save the patients. Uncontrolled diabetes mellitus and use of steroids for the treatment of respiratory symptoms are the possible etiological factors that everyone is aware of this. And mucormycosis can be life-threatening as it has high mortality rate of over 50%. 50% of the patients are having a mortality rate. So what are the possible reasons for mucormycosis in COVID-19 patients? Hyperglycemia due to uncontrolled pre-existing diabetes and high prevalence rates of mucormycosis in India per se. So rampant overuse of irrational use of steroids in management of COVID-19. And also the self-medications. Many of us do self-medications. Many of the general public, they search on Google, they find out from friends, find out the family doctors, over the telephone they ask and they start steroids. By doing taking steroids in the beginning itself, you may minimize the symptoms, but you are doing more harm to yourself. Always the word of caution should be used when you use steroids. So the number of cases increased basically because of this excessive use of steroids. So new onset diabetes due to steroid overuse or severe cases of COVID-19 per se, it's also possible cause of mucormycosis. Prolonged ICU stay and irrational use of broad spectrum antibiotics also are the possible causes. Pre-existing comorbidities such as hematological malignancies, use of immunosuppressants, solid organ transplants, and also patients with pre-existing lymphomas, or patients with the pre-existing kidney failures, renal failures, AIDS, liver cirrhosis, and neutropenia, all these are, and also malnutrition. Malnutrition is also anemia. Hemoglobin level less than 10 is also one of the causes. So malnutrition, where the immunity is reduced, more prone for fungal opportunistic infections. So other than this, humidification of air with the unclean water is also one of the possible causes. And use of industrial grade of oxygen is also one of the possible reasons. And too much of use of zinc self-medication, too much of steam inhalations, and self-medication. All these are the major causes for mucormycosis. Coming to the symptoms, it is based on the type of mucormycosis you have. Basically, in mucormycosis, we have a cerebral or rhino-orbitocerebral, where the symptoms in and around the mouth, nose, and eyes, and headache. And you have a pulmonary mucormycosis, you have cutaneous, you have a gastrointestinal mucormycosis. A lot of reported cases during COVID-19 is more of a rhinocerebral mucormycosis compared to other varieties. So here, this mucormycosis is a very uncommon but rapidly progressive angio-invasive. It invades the vessels and commonly fatal opportunistic fungal infection. And we need, in these type of infections, multidisciplinary approach is mandatory. Here, ENT surgeons are involved, ophthalmologists are involved, neurophysician, urologist, neurosurgeon, and physician, oral and maxillofacial surgeon, and of course, dental surgeon. It's a team approach, all are involved to control this disease or prevent the complications. So the symptoms may include severe headache if it is involving the cerebrum, or a patient will have a frontal headache, patient will have a congestion, nasal congestion, a discharge from the nose, black or brown discharge, or discoloration of the skin around the mouth and the nose, and patients will have a diplopia, double vision, blindness, ultimately blindness, coma, and death. So this is the depending on the symptoms is mainly basically based on the degree of involvement, the site of involvement, and when the patient reported to us. So in the oral cavity, we have a different symptoms, which I will come to later. So here, what are the investigation needed? Non-contrast CT, contrast should never be given. Non-contrast CT, PNS, and high resolution CT, and MRI. MRI is basically to check the extent of involvement, the involvement of the optic nerve, involvement of the soft tissues, and how aggressively lesion is progressing. All these can be, we'll have a better picture, better delineation of the necrosis with the MRI. So diagnosis, basically, nasal smear is sufficient along with that nasal biopsy, nasal endoscopy. We can take a scoop of a tissue and we can do the biopsy. We will, if you do potassium hydroxide staining, and a microscopy, histopathology of a debrided tissue and a culture, you will get a presence of ribbon-like aspartate hyphae, 5 to 15 micron, that branch at right angles. So these, most of the time, this diagnosis is more of a clinical rather than this histopathological diagnosis. We will have a typical clinical presentation based on which we can easily diagnose these with the proper history, with the clinical judgment, one can easily come to a conclusion, diagnosis. So this mucormycosis infiltrates the vascular lamina. I said it is angio-invasive for the same reason, and causing infraction and necrosis as well as the inflammation. So this necrosis can cause us thrombus. It occludes the vessels, and when the vessel is occluded, then progressive tissue necrosis can occur at different anatomical sites. Depending on how fungal exposure takes place, this can be through inhalation, ingestion, and direct contact, or with the traumatic inoculation. So affects the head and neck, respiratory, central, and gastrointestinal tract, as I mentioned, and the disease symptoms based on these. Rhinocerebral mucormycosis affects the head and neck, with the most common site being the nose, but the disease can spread to the paranasal sinus, orbit, facial bones, and can spread everywhere. And it is very nicely explained in this British Journal of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery 2020 by Michelle Rao et al. So we just can make a note of this. This is the clinical picture of my friends, so not my pictures. See, you can see here the discoloration is happening, and intraorally multiple sinuses you can see, discharge, pus discharge sinus, and again here pus has been, you can see the pus here,
and multiple intraoral sinuses and buccal sinus, palatal swelling. See the sinus here, and palatally there is a swelling. So here comes the role of our dental surgeons. What mind knows only eyes can see. Here, if a dental surgeon is aware of this, he can always spot on, he can diagnose, and we can immediately refer to the right person. The tissue necrosis can be avoided. We can do a better, we can have a good prognosis. See the palatal necrosis, discoloration. Beginning of the palatal necrosis, you can see the non-healing extraction sockets, and also here. And the bone is exposed here. So in this scenario, immediately we have to refer so that the patient is benefited. And dental surgeons make a note, loose tooth, gingival abscess, dental extractions are often the first symptoms of presenting to the oral and maxillofacial surgeons. So with the history of COVID, recovered from COVID, even after 6 months, recovered from COVID-19, these symptoms can, mucormycosis can happen. So one should be extremely, extremely careful. So mucormycosis in the bone marrow may promote fungal growth by damaging the endothelial lining of the vessels, resulting in vascular insufficiency, leading to a bone necrosis and fungal osteomyelitis. So this complication is more aggressive than the more commonly seen bacterial associated osteomyelitis. Generally, it is the Staph aureus and other related bacteria which cause osteomyelitis, can be treated. Sometimes even if you don't treat, it will become a chronic osteomyelitis and it will never become a life-threatening. Whereas in mucormycosis, if you don't identify and don't treat, we are going to lose the patient. Here comes the clinical acumen, clinical efficiency, and the decision-making capacity of the doctor or the surgeon, where you have to take a right decision at the right time to save the patients. So angioinvasive nature of the mucormycosis is characterized by the thrombosing the vasculitis, and it is and its role in the host invasion has been attributed to the increased expression of the palatal platelet derived growth factors signaling. So fatality rates for severe mucormycosis infections can be close to 100%, not even 50%, it's 100%. So when mucormycosis is suspected, adequate imaging and documentation has to be disease. Documentation of the extent of the disease is advised, followed by the surgical debridement. Documentation, as I said, MRI is a must, so that we can identify how progressive, how extensive is the lesion one can make out. And immediate surgical debridement is the need of the hour, and medical therapy is not sufficient. As a surgeon, you have to take a decision. You have to do an aggressive resection of the debride and of the necrosed bone along with the normal margin, and immediately, and then a medical therapy. Of course, the high dose liposomal amphotericin B is the drug of choice. The first line of drug itself is amphotericin. It's a highly nephrotoxic drug. Renal function has to be assessed before starting this drug. So one has to be extremely careful while starting this drug. Renal function assessment is a must, and one has to monitor the patient. The dosage is, some textbook says 1 mg/kg per day. Ideally, it is 5 mg/kg per day. And in severe cases, immunocompromised cases, you can give up to 10 mg/kg per day. So ideally 2 to 3 grams a day is sufficient. No clear-cut evidence, the literature is available, but for a general protocol, we follow 5 mg/kg per day. So intravenous isoconazole, intravenous or delayed release tablet posaconazole also has been advocated. This has been again a British Journal of Maxillofacial Surgery by Rao Vishal et al. So one has to, if you refer this, we'll get a good guidelines. Coming to the last slide. So what is the protocol one has to follow? By the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, COVID-19 infection, rhino-orbital mucormycosis. So here, multidisciplinary mucormycosis clinical team, ENT surgeon, maxillofacial surgeon, dental surgeon, ophthalmologist, neurophysician, neurosurgeon, everybody to be in place. to categorize positive and negative admission as per the categorization. If it is a positive, as per the protocol, many patients with mucor noted to be COVID percent positive. So more than 10 days onset. So one has to categorize them. Then checklist for the signs and symptoms. Nose, sinuses, mucor, mycor infections. So here early detection, as I mentioned previous slides, headache, nasal crusting, pain, loss of sensation on face, discoloration of the skin and face, and all these symptoms. It is what I mentioned in the previous slides, same orbital eye swellings, redness, double vision, loss of vision, eye pain, drooping of eyelids, proptosis, exophthalmos, all these things. So treatment protocol is here. Why these increased incidence of mucormycosis? See, COVID-19 tends to worsen in diabetes, worsen the diabetes and also precipitate diabetes in previously normal individuals. And COVID-19 infection itself is associated with the leukopenia, then may lead to immune compromise caused by the impaired or inappropriate immune responses. So immune suppressive treatments are being widely used for treatment of COVID-19 infections. So the severity of mucor infection is largely dependent on the patient's immunity and general health. Coexistence of COVID-19 infection with high blood sugar levels, immunocompressive treatment would expectedly increase the incidence of severity of mucormycosis. So mucor infection may occur during COVID-19 infection or after a few weeks, even after a few months, maybe after 6 months also it can happen. So one should be extremely careful. The protocol what we should follow is treatment of comorbid illness and blood sugar control and of COVID illness. It is the need of the hour. We have to control the sugar. We have to control the COVID illness to review the COVID treatments to minimize the immunocompromise. So immunocompromise, when you are giving other medications, broad spectrum antibiotics and other things to control the super infection with the added infection with the bacteria, one should be careful. Twice daily evaluation as per the mucor checklist and confirmation of the diagnosis by the smear as well as CT and MRI. Then antifungal treatment, as I mentioned, amphotericin B or and oral posaconazole. Amphotericin 5 mg/kg body weight per day, and along with this aggressive surgical resection of the necrosed portion and early surgical debridement after stabilization of the systemic illness, ensuring the facilities for the post-surgical care and ventilation as anticipated. So all these is the final protocol one we should follow for the management of the mucormycosis cases. So finally, I would like to conclude. I'm nearing 1 hour, the last slide. Oral and maxillofacial surgery services for the public during health crisis such as COVID-19 pandemic are important for the public health and should be available under safeguarded conditions. I repeat, safeguarded conditions. We should take proper precautions until and otherwise patient proved negative. We should consider them as positive and all the possible precautions, all possible personal protective equipment has to be taken. And in the present situation, the main concern is to provide effective treatment to patients with the conditions that cannot be deferred or controlled by the pharmacological management. So in that case, while simultaneously taking care to minimize the risk of COVID-19 to the practitioner and the patient and the hospital staff by strictly following the formulated guidelines. So one has to do the telephonic triage, including the telemedicine smartphone applications, is to be advocated for a quick and early diagnosis of the disease and the personal protective equipments to meet the ever existing demand should be implemented in all centers dealing with the COVID-19 patients. So if you follow all these protocols, I don't find any reason to defer the treatment. If it is needed, we have to do it. A good surgeon is the one who delivers when actually needed. And final word of caution, when in doubt, you do it. So that is the message. Please take all the possible precautions, COVID guidelines, following the guidelines, you intervene, take a right decision at the right time, you can save the patient and also prevent the spread of the disease. Thank you very much. I conclude.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Now over to Dr. Rupashree to take up question answer. Dr. Rupashree?
Dr. Rupashree?
Dr. Rupashree?
Yes, sir. So, good afternoon to one and all. Thank you very much, Dr. Mohli Mohan Chittaru, sir, for your talk on oral and maxillofacial surgeon.
Thank you.
On management of dental and maxillofacial surgical patients during COVID-19 pandemic. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
We have got participants telling that session was very informative. And also I would like to share the information that this program will be recorded and it will be hosted in official RGHS website, YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook for further reference. Gautam, do we have any hand raise options for the questions?
No, madam.
We have no questions in the chat box, sir. So I'll hand over the session to Dayanand, sir.
Dr. Dayanand?
Yes, I'm here.
Dr. Dayanand, there are no questions, you can conclude.
Yeah, I'm concluding. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Yes. On behalf of the Registrar and Vice Chancellor of Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences, I thank the today's speaker, Dr. Murali Mohan Chuntaru, for his very clear, informative, and excellent talk on the management of dental and maxillofacial surgical patients during COVID-19 pandemic. We thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
We thank the Echo India for their cooperation for this webinar. And then we thank all the participants who have participated in today's program. And we thank the officers of the RGHS, Dr. B.J. Mahendra, Dr. Rupashree, and Kirti and Som Shekhar for their participation in the program. And we thank one and all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. So the next program details are, we have another program on July 9th of 2021, that is on Friday at 3 p.m. The topic of the next lecture is breastfeeding and COVID-19. The speaker, we have three speakers for the next session, and that is on 9th. The first speaker is Dr. Mallikarjuna H.V. He is he is a founder secretary, IYCFK chapter, international course director and national trainer for IYCF and HIV. He will be speaking on breastfeeding and COVID-19. Another renowned speaker, we have Dr. C.R. Banapurmat. The topic of his speech is overview of pediatric nutrition and severe acute malnutrition and COVID-19. The third topic will be overweight and obesity and COVID-19 in infants and young children. The speaker will be Dr. Dinakar More. So I request all the participants to make use of this session by logging on to RGHS website and the link which will be shared with you on July 9th at 3 p.m. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Gautam, close the meeting.
Okay.
Okay, right.